their sights on blitzkrieg, lightning war to gain rapid success, but failed to tap the impressive might of the bomber. As only a tactical tool, the German bomber is soon outclassed by Allied shelling. Efforts at the 11th hour to match U.S. and British warplanes would be in vain. Although the airplane had been used as a bomber even before World War I, it was not until the Second World War that it came of age as a major weapon. The countries of the Axis alliance led this development. From 1939 to the end of 1942, tactical bombing was the major reason for the stunning Axis victories throughout Europe, Russia, and the Far East. But there was a flaw in their plan. Believing in the concept of blitzkrieg, the Axis powers only developed bombers of limited range and payload for tactical use. They didn't pay enough attention to the devastating potential of strategic bombing. And in the end, it was Allied strategic bombing which burned the hearts out of Germany and Japan. In 1935, Hitler, totally ignoring the Treaty of Versailles, built up a large and capable arms industry in Germany. Factories were geared up to produce weapons of war in mass quantities. The course of the air war soon showed that too little thought had been given to the development of new generations of warplanes, so the Luftwaffe had to carry on with types which had been designed before 1939. The Heinkel 111 was the mainstay of the German medium bomber arm throughout the Second World War, despite the fact that the prototype flew as early as February 1935. The plane was developed as a civilian airliner, and some early aircraft were indeed delivered as high-speed transports. The first bomber flew in October 1936, and over 7,000 were manufactured between then and 1944, when production ceased. Within the limitations imposed by the small airframe, the Heinkel 111 was developed into a remarkably effective warplane, which was used in a variety of roles. The first models had a conventional fuselage with a stepped cockpit, but from early 1939, this was replaced by the more familiar extensively glazed nose. This was asymmetric, with the machine gun offset, so the pilot's forward view was not blocked. Early versions were powered by a pair of Daimler-Benz engines, but these were soon replaced by more powerful Junkers Jumo 211s. These new engines produced 1,200 horsepower and gave the aircraft a top speed of 270 miles per hour at 20,000 feet, with a range of 1,200 miles. The Heinkel normally had a crew of five, and defensive armament was composed of 5 to 7 machine guns, the forward part of the ventral gondola often being replaced by a 20-millimeter cannon. During the course of the war, the 111 equipped 30 bomber Geschwader. These were the equivalent of an Allied group, and in turn were subdivided into 3 or 4 Kampfgruppen, each of about 30 aircraft, further divided into 3 or 4 Staffeln, or squadrons. Operationally, they flew in a fairly tight formation to give overlapping support against enemy fighters. The 111 was used as the test bed for a variety of radar installations designed mainly to be fitted to other aircraft, one of the most successful being the FUG-200 anti-shipping device. The nose machine gun was replaced by a 20-millimeter cannon in these versions. The Germans also pioneered the use of radio direction finding as a navigational aid. The Heinkel 111 was among several bomber types to use the Nickebein and later X and Y Gerät systems, which allowed the aircraft to follow a radio beam to its target. The Luftwaffe's most infamous success using these methods was the raid on Coventry on November 14, 1940. British scientists soon developed means of bending or jamming these beams, sending the bombers off course. On the actual bombing run, a fairly simple optical sight was used. But this was enough to provide accurate bombing from both low and medium altitudes. A typical bomb load was 8 550-pound bombs, stored in two bays on either side of a central gangway. The 111 was also developed as a torpedo bomber and as a carrier for anti-shipping missiles. A selector switch on the starboard side of the cockpit allowed the radio-controlled guidance system to be used with either the Ruhrstahl X-1 glide bomb, known as the Fritz X, or with the rocket-propelled Henschel 293. These weapons were used with devastating effect on ground targets and shipping. The operator moved into the nose where the Kehl Strasburg control unit was installed and inserted a small lever. Once the target was in sight, the guidance apparatus was switched on. Then, when the operator said the word, the pilot pressed the trigger and released the missile, or in some cases, a Henschel 293D, which had a television camera in its nose. Then the operator guided the missile to its target using the joystick. On a typical bombing run over England, the Heinkels learned to approach at low level over the coastline in order to avoid the risk of radar detection, which could mean a swift and deadly enemy response. Practically skimming the treetops at times, they made themselves less vulnerable to fighters or anti-aircraft fire. Nearing the target, they had to climb to a bombing altitude of about 6,000 feet. They were always closely escorted by Messerschmitt 109 fighters for protection against enemy attack. Because of their method of loading, the bombs dropped out of a Heinkel 111's bomb bays tail first, resulting in the odd wobble typical of the aircraft's bombing technique. The Heinkel 111 served in all the German campaigns from Poland, Norway, France, and Britain to the Balkans, North Africa, and Russia. It performed equally well as a bomber, transport, glider tug, and even as the carrier for air-launched V-1 flying bombs. As the turbulent 30s drew to a close, the world watched in horror as Europe was scarred with the devastating effects from the blitzkrieg tactics of Germany's Luftwaffe. Another pre-war design was the Dornier 17, which was originally developed as a high-speed mail plane for the German national airline Lufthansa. First flying in 1934, the aircraft was appropriately nicknamed the Flying Pencil because of its thin fuselage. This made the passenger space very cramped, and it was never adopted for passenger use. The Dornier was redesigned with a new nose and with double instead of single tails. The aircraft was put into service as a bomber in 1934. The Dornier first saw action with the Condor Legion during the Spanish Civil War. Unfortunately, the slender fuselage restricted the size of the bomb bay, and the Dornier 17 could only carry half the Heinkel 111's load. Various prototypes of the Dornier were built as bombers and reconnaissance.